My name is Torben Hoffman, the Hoff at Twitter. That's the only French thing about me, by the way. Nothing else. Lame there. This summer I joined Basho as an architect, and previous to that I used Erlang in Anchor at Motorola. Talked about that a few times. And I was with Erlang Solutions for a couple of years, but now I'm an architect at Basho. You all know what architect means. It means that you say wine liners and people think you know everything. And I know nothing, but there you go. So one of the things trying to alleviate the I know nothing problem when you start in the company is to look at the software, right? It's what you do, because you produce software. So I started looking at the React core code, and I realized that a lot of smart people had been in there. They were developing a lot of code. And then I said, okay, this is a little difficult to get into, especially because there are like minus 10 lines of code per file in the entire code base, which makes it a bit difficult. So I looked around at how are other people using React core, because they're using it. And it turns out what they do is, just go back here, they're jumping through this hoop of fire. You remember Madagascar 3, Europe's Most Wanted. So this tiger has a living in a circus, and he jumps through a ring of fire. It's quite difficult. It's painful, but you do it because it's a living. And this is what people are doing when they're using React core. They're jumping through a ring of fire. Really cool. Yeah. And what we do at Basho, so we are that sneaky tiger now. We're telling people it's good for you.
You just need a little bit. Okay. Don't shake.
There we go, right? We try again. It's working now. Hopefully it'll stay there. We'll try. Okay. So we're the tiger here. We tell people you can use React core. You can go through the ring. It just takes a little bit of breeze. It'll be fine. You won't feel a thing. And the thing is, we've developed nice software, and then we've told people, and then those people, they go use React core. And it ends up like this. That's just not fair. And then you need to say, okay, can we do something about this? So there are a number of steps you can do, and we will slowly but steadily try to make it less painful for people like Heinz to use React core. So let's try and go through some of the issues there are there. So the dream, yeah. Sometimes you smoke stuff, and then you start dreaming, whoa, I just want to throw in a one-liner in my rebuttal config or Erlang.mk, and it just works. React core just works. This is the dream scenario.
Sure.
Yeah,
yes,
exactly. And just as a warning here, and I want this on record, some of the opinions that will come out here are not necessarily those of my employer. Then it will be the Erlang priest inside of me that goes on a rant and a crusade. He has a different opinion to what he needs to get done at work. So just keep that in mind. You will not be in doubt when that happens. Don't worry. We have it on record now. So this just doesn't happen. No. One of the problems is, and this is the inclusion tree of React core, where you look at the rebar.config, the app.source. And there are no USB sticks for figuring out that which color is bad here. Of course, the red color. Red color is bad. And that's because from the React core application, we do calls to Folsom. But we have not included it in the rebar.config. We have not included it in the .app.source file. We just call it because we know it's there. That's no way to do it. That's not how you want to do an OTP thing. You have the same thing with the runtime tools. Well, yeah. So that's something you need to fix there. Because it has an impact. Doing these dirty things has an impact on when you generate a release. And look, if you look at this one, you will see like, here you have Amnesia. Amnesia is your friend. It follows things, and it shows up with a version number after it in the lib dir. But anything that comes from React core, third-party dependencies or whatever, they come without a version number. This is bad. This is not OTP stuff. But it's also it's a blessing in disguise, because that means if you are a guy sitting somewhere with a lot of knowledge about OTP, you have a reason to write a book. Hint, hint. So, but this is one of the things you need to get fixed. So how do we get to that? Okay. One of the first things is we revisit the tree, and we need to get the red stuff away, and we'll talk about that yellow-like color over there later. So, the decent thing, of course, you just add these things to your rebutter config and your app.source source file, and then they will turn green. I don't have an image for that, but just imagine that they turn green. But there are more things. There are like evil things in the way React Core is doing things. And that is React Ensemble. So that's our little friend up here with that, whatever color we call that, amber or something, or orange. There. It's not good, because it's not started as an application. It is started by the top-level supervisor inside React Core. Starts the top-level supervisor of React Ensemble. And it only does that if the strong consistency flag is on. So that's a configuration parameter. And that means that running these things as an OTP release is difficult. And you can ask Francesco if it's a very good idea to start top-level supervisors of other applications inside your own application. And yeah, do that over beer there. So, and then the fix here is actually quite easy. You make starting of these the supervisor React Ensemble soup, the children, you make that starting dynamic. Because this is an Erlang, we can do all sorts of dynamic things there. And that also means that instead of what you do today, where you need to take down the entire node to enable strong consistency, you can do it on the fly. Which just sounds like something you do in Erlang, do such stuff on the fly. And that requires a little bit of work. So that means that you put the children into separate functions so you can get them back. And here you see there's another child here with a macro and boom, 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 and they do what they do. And then you start each child intelligently. Somehow this is not inside the OTP code, but here I've written a function to ensure that a child has been started. And it depends, I mean, you call this one, you want to make sure you don't crash things. So there's a lot of, you can read the documentation, and this basically is about getting the supervisor to start the child, and depending on the return code for that one, you figure out how to do things and do some cleaning up. And then you can do this, start stuff when requested. So you can engage here and disengage. And that means just folding over the list of children and make sure they're all started with the ensure child thing. And that means that in the ensemble manager, you can start ensemble and you can stop ensemble. And you can do that on the fly. And I've done that three times in the one VM session. So that's the amount of testing it has received so far, but it just works. So.
Try 7.
Yeah, okay, 7, I'm good. Okay, thank you. I'll do that. We're almost there. We're 50% complete on the testing of this there. So, but that's the kind of thing you can do. And it will be the same thing if you have the same kind of thing in your application, do these kind of tricks. And that also means that, just to throw that in, I'm not only going to talk about things related to React Core, I'll also talk about how this impacts you guys doing other Erlang things. So if you don't give a rat's ass about React Core, if you do not want that oil stuff and jumping through rings of fire, there's still stuff for you in this talk. Good. Then, dependency nightmare. How many of you have felt the dependency nightmare in Erlang? You used React Core, yes, so you have all the pain. So there's like 15 people here. Lovely. I have stuff for you. So, for instance, and this is one of the things that hit us at Basho recently, EBAR was updated in one of the dependencies. And then it's a shared dependency, there are two pointing to it, and then having two different versions, the entire build blew up in the face of the poor engineer that had no idea about Erlang's crappy dependency management. And if you've tried this, you will know that this resembles pain-driven development. It is almost as painful as coding in Java. So you do not want to go down into this. You want to avoid this. So how do we do this? So then I tried something. And this is here, hashtag not my employer's view right now, but I will get them convinced by bitching about it forever. thing. I tried to build with Erlang.mk. That's the kind of thing you do on your own machine and not on a Basho machine, because repo is like, that's the church of, So it required only two things to work, because I tried to do this build out of the box with React Core, and everything was just throwing up into my face with these dependencies. But Erlang.mk, throw in a compile first for two files, update the Click version, that's one of the dependencies, and it worked. I got something out of there that had taken me 2 days to get going with Reba. By the way, I hate Reba. With a vengeance.
Both versions?
All versions. Period. Okay. Yeah. I took the blue pill. I'm sorry. So, but I'm also practical. It might be that Reba 3 will come out, but still, come on. Make 38 years of engineering, and we're just going to say, throw that out, I'm smarter, I can do my own stuff. Okay. That's a different thing. That's a different thing. Back on track, 1 second. Need to get my blood pressure down again. So, yeah. So, but it doesn't ensure that we get all the versions we want. We get a version. And the good thing about the Erlang.mk, it's predictable. It might do shit in terms of picking versions, but it does the same thing every time. If you're the kind of person that likes to get random stuff every time you run the same command, use MongoDB. Just saying. Yeah. So this is a good step forward. So then you have these version problems. So how do we resolve them? Yeah. So all doing this by hand. This can be done. How many of you have tried resolving a big dependency tree and resolving all the dependencies by hand and go and fixing every repo you've used in the entire tree? How many have done that by hand? Yeah? Are you still smiling when you talk about Erlang? No. Wobbly head over here. Just shaking head down there. So, the way to solve this, of course, Columbo, the dependency detective. We need somebody to help us. Again, it should be a separate tool because it's a separate problem. I can rant about this for hours, so we will get into that. So what does Columbo do? By the way, everybody knows what Columbo is. Sort of. Yeah, I was at a conference with young people and they're like, Columbo? What's that? Okay, so what Columbo does, Columbo is very, very stupid because he needs to make a very simple thing take a long time so it fills up 45 minutes of a TV episode. He doesn't need to drag it out. So Columbo is very simplistic in this way. So what it does is it takes the top level, it only works for reboot.config right now, there. Also because reboot.config is the root of all evil, so there we go. But it goes through your reboot.config and then it iteratively goes through all your dependencies. And it picks up all different versions used down through the dependency tree. All of them. No questions asked. It's been tested on my machine, it works. And I have a colleague using it as well, so slightly confident. So what you'll see here is, you have a top level thing, you can't see that it says rear core. Trust me, you can get the slides later and enlarge the image and you'll see it says rear core. But then you have all the dependencies going down, and what you will notice here is that some of these square boxes, they have two boxes in there. That is bad. That is because somehow the entire dependency tree wants two different versions of the same package. You do not want that. You want one and only one. There can be only one in these things. And this tool, again, being simplistic, it just highlights everything, and then it's up to the astute reader to figure out how to solve the problem. But at least it tells you where the problem is. Because this is the kind of thing that where engineers go, no, I have to figure out all of this. This one pointed out there. I have not added nasty colors to it. I should, of course, make this one not dripping red or something to show, but I figured if you can't spot that there are two ellipses inside a square, I don't think colors is going to help you very much. But at least it tells you what the problem is, and then you can start working your way up in a systematic manner. It's still close to pain-driven development, but you don't have to think about where the pain is. You can take decisions based on one drawing, so that's nice. It's on GitHub, very, very much work in progress. Please try it out. Throw a pull request. Tell me that I'm smoking stuff. It doesn't even do half what it promises to do. And it only works with Reba-based projects now. So I need at some point to get into supporting Erlang.mk as well, so I can traverse. No? I don't. Yes?
But you are using pure Erlang, I mean, Reba configs without evaluation, because you could also evaluate halfly like configuration, right? So you don't have support for it. When configuration is dynamically evaluated in the river, you're not supporting it. You're just passing the pure terms. That's it.
Yes.
Okay.
I only do the static stuff. But I do make sure that I check out each tag that is pointed to through the entire thing.
Okay.
And then I traverse iteratively down from that tag to make sure I get everything socked out.
Okay.
It's not a lot of code. It's just a few recursive functions and two cups of coffee, and then you're there. And okay, it's also about solving the first problem first. We had issues with Rebar because we used Rebar all the place, so it supports Rebar. So if somebody wants to add support for Erlang.mk, I'm all for it. Because, even Erlang.mk projects will also have to state their dependencies, and you can get into the same sharing of dependencies with different versions. There. So it's good to be highlighted that you have an issue. And by the way, seeing this graph early and detect the problem, it's a lot more fun than after you ship the thing to a customer. Lot more fun. Oh, I thought I shipped this one. By the way, never say that on a conference call with a customer. Oh, I thought I shipped the right version. Don't do that. But this one will help you and avoid the problem up front. And every money you save on this, 10% of it goes to me. So you've all been biotech by the lunch, by the way. So I can trace you back. If you've been to this talk and this conference, I can trace you back. Don't worry. So, good. And now, because this is also where I'm lazy. Yes, say it out loud. I'm a mathematician. Well, I'm an engineer, but I have so much math that I'm in doubt about what I am. But I know I'm lazy. So I want to be able to build a release very, very easily. And the tool for doing that is relics, which, by the way, if you want to go down the dreaded route to Rebar 3, you need to have relics anyway. So it's a good step, no matter what. And here, this is my relics file to build a release. 3 lines. Go in, check the rel tool files for React KV. If there are more than 3 lines, I have a beer, right?
You'll be drunk.
I'll be drunk, yes. Then what does that do? Now that we fixed these things, we have relics doing things for you. Look at this. What is this? The numbers. Everything. Cuttlefish that didn't have a number. It now has a number. Then there's some weird stuff here. We can take that over beer, what that is. But look at it. Numbers all over the place. If you need to, now's the time to get your Kleenex, because this is how an Erlang OTP library should look like, with version numbers and everything. And if you don't appreciate that, buy a book about it. It's coming out soon. So, good.
Nice meeting.
Well, I'm not getting percentages, so there you go.
Yeah, sure.
So, oh, that didn't go down well. Okay, fair enough, but still, get the book anyway. Don't trust me, just get it.
You can find it on BitTorrent
as well. So, of course you can. Anything valuable will be on BitTorrent.
Okay.
Yeah. But do support Francesco, because he's put a lot of effort into that one. Next steps on Columbo. Not necessarily by me, it could also be some of you guys going, yes, we want to have sanity in our work with dependencies in Erlang. Get some overlays in place, proper configuration files, for sanity with React Core, and then figure out that this cluster info thing that I didn't talk about, that should be a utility, because it's really got nothing to do but something. Sometimes you want to go in and ask some health thing about what's going on in your React Core application. Why should that? It could be on the side, but yeah, so good. Now we've done some hygiene, we cleaned up, washed our hands, and got React Core to be a little bit nicer. So now we want to use it. This is where Heinz has been in pain, but how do you use it? So I'll explain a few things about it, and then you can see other talks that go into great details about something, but I thought that some of the fundamentals here that started me when I was looking at, that's how it does. I'll go into some of that, and there will be places where I say, rigorous hand-waving, I have not figured this out yet. And then, Heinz, you are a dangerous man.
Oh, it's too late.
It's too late. Do not stare into the ring. It's dangerous. He showed you a ring picture and he didn't give you a warning. Do not stare into the ring. It'll hypnotize you and you'll be sucked in. But again, being sucked into the React ring is better than being sucked into MongoDB. So, so the ring. Yeah. So, by the way, if you've seen any other people from Basho talk, we have to show this.
Yeah, always.
Always. You see, we can't do a talk without showing the ring.
Always.
Yeah. So, yeah, we had a very elaborate bonus scheme at Basho. First, show the rear ring, check. No,
not in plain sight.
I cannot show you my tattoo. So, so yeah. So what happens is that you have a key space, and then you divide it up into a number of partitions. There, and of course, people have to go all in. So the key space and the numbers all go up to 2 to the 160th. That is a fairly big number, because you want to be able to make very big rings. Why stop at something simple? You go to 2 to the 160th. And then...
My precious.
But it's precious. Exactly. So, and then you do not want... Here we have a simple system with 32 positions, partitions. You could have those partitions served each by one physical machine, but that's not how you want to do it, because it gets really costly. Sometimes you want to have a ring partition of 128, meaning you have to have 128 machines. It gets out of hand at some point. So what you do is you have a number of nodes, of each of them serves a number of these partitions. So that's the core fundamental principle of using the ring. And that means that when you talk about these things, you will see terms like nodes and vnode come up. So the node is a physical machine. The vnode is an Erlang process responsible for one of those partitions you saw on the ring. Do not make a one-to-one ratio between the two. Your boss will hate you. And your finance director will fire you after you fired off 2048.
Huh? Get a drop at Dell.
Yeah, you can do that. Yeah, but if you do it on Amazon, you will fire out 2048 machines without knowing it. And yeah, good luck at that performance review. So, and then you have the one node handle, so vnodes. And here you can see that the node 0 will handle the positions 0, 4, 8, 12, 16, up to 28. If you have a number of nodes, not, well, it's not divisible into the number of partitions, some weird stuff happens that I haven't figured out yet. I just looked into the code and I saw dragons and spewing fire and everything. I was like, oh, I do not want to understand that algorithm right now. So there's some magic happening when things don't add up there. You're warned when you look into the code there. So, and the way it works is, the starting point here is, so here we have the four nodes there. And here you can see that node 0 is handling partition 0, 4, and then some more. And then 1, 5, 2, 6, 3, 9. So this is the starting point. Everybody's happy. The V nodes are being there. So now you need to get a request going to one of these V nodes. You want to contact it because it's responsible for some part of your problem. And the problem could be different things. We'll talk about it given time later. So the naive routing would be you have a request coming in and you have a router. Everybody's written some router in their software. We need to dispatch things. And then it figures out, this request should be handled by this vnode on this machine. The problem here is, this is a single point of failure. Anybody here in favor of single point of failure? you need more oil, dude. So no, you don't want that. So what is happening in React Core, and also what's coming directly out of the Dynamo architecture is, you have a request, it hits a random node, because it got one of those there, and then it that node reroutes it to the correct node. So that's what's going on under the hood. So if you see a weird traffic when you're doing things, it's because you didn't hit the right one in the first go, which if you're doing it randomly, you can't do anyway. So this is how the rerouting happens. Now, any system you will build will crash on you, period. Ask Heinz, he's got scars all over his back from this there. So what happens is, when you have chosen node 2 to fail, those V nodes, those processes there, are then being started on the other physical nodes. So they're being spread out, again, according to some algorithm that I do not understand at this point, but it's been distributed out. So everybody shares the load here. And that means that if you're doing a request now, that has to hit one of those V nodes that you were previously on node 2, it'll go to one of the other nodes where that V node is now executing. So when one machine is out, you'll still get service, thing will go to these things, but it'll be a new process handling it. And then when you have a node coming back, or a new node there, that new node will realize, I have to be node 2 in this cluster. Which V node should I run? I need to run 2, 6, and 10. And then you have copies. And then you can only have one V node. Eventually, there should be only one. You cannot have two V nodes, because who should serve things? And that means, if you put one back here, everything, for instance, if you're storing data in your V nodes, some people do that. They build databases on top of React Core. And then they store the data in the V nodes. When the V nodes die, that data is gone. This is why we have replication and other things going on, but I'll show you that in a few minutes. So here, now we need to figure out, how do we fix the stuff that happened while this node was away? We need to consolidate to only have one V node, the V number 2 here. There should only be one instance of this, and it should hold all the data relevant for that V node there. And that means that you need to do handoff. That's the mysterious handoff people are talking about in React. But that's actually those people that were sitting there taking care of the guy that was dead and gone. They said, oh, you're back. Here's what I collected for you while you were away. And this is why you have to implement handoff if you're doing V nodes in React and using React Core. And then the whole process runs through, you deliver all your stuff, and then eventually say, I'm done, and you kill yourself. So the process just kills itself after done a good job, which is good. And then eventually everything will be on the new node. So that's how these things fit together. And that means that you need to implement a behavior function here for being a V node, and that's the handoff command. And that basically means all data relevant for the real master here, you need to bundle that up and send it across. That's what's happening here in the handoff command. And you can this is taken from Reseki, GitHub repo there, and you can see a lot more detail about this. But this is what you need to do. So these are the underlying principles, and this way you get to. Then, errors. Because sometimes these node fails there, and you want to be certain that when you write data, say, to n nodes, that after a number of them has succeeded, you're happy. Say you write out to 3. I don't know why we use 3, but it's just a number that came to me right now. Write out to 3 nodes and say if 2 of them have done the write, then you're happy. You know, the 2 of the nodes you ask to do something, they've taken care of it. So then you're happy. So that one, for dealing with it, you need to do coordination there. And then you generate, the typical trick here is, you generate a GenFSM that will do the sending to these end nodes and collect replies back. And when you have received enough OKs, you say, I'm done, I don't need to track anymore, this write has now successfully completed. And this is actually React KB in one slide. This is what it does, plus some dev things, what have you, there. But that's how you need to do it. But basically what you need to do is you start off as an FSM, you initialize things, and then you set requests out to all these other vnodes from the init state, the init function, to say, I want to write here, and it goes off, and then you go into a waiting state, because basically this is GenFSM at one state, but bear with me, it's okay to do that. And then when you get a reply, and you say, oh, I need more replies to make sure that I'm happy about this, you wait until you have enough replies, and then you go and stop the FSM, and then you're happy. So this is the very, very basic case. Then, sometimes, the stuff you want to do before you can send a command off might take a very long time. And then we have the max, and you should not spend too much time in the init function. So you want to do that, all that ceremony in another state. Okay, fair enough. So then you create a prepare state. So you prepare these things and send out the commands and everything, and it happens in the prepare state. And then you have the same thing again in the waiting state. You wait for replies from all the other vnodes. When enough answers have come in, you stop and say, I'm happy, everything is good. And this then brings us on to the next thing. And this is where the bio-tracking comes in for the second time. You've been to this presentation. If you ever do the next thing, I can track you down. And I'll promise you, the rest of your software career, it will not be about maintaining software. It will not be about coding Java Enterprise software. It will be about maintaining Java Enterprise software. Just so you want, right? Yeah. Do not ever, never, ever use a zero timeout to transition between states in a Jennifer. I'm going to put up a watch on GitHub. I'm going to track down every project that does this. And I'll have your GitHub handles, all of them. If you do this, I'm going to get medieval on you. I'm sorry. So, yeah, never ever do that there. So what you want to do in these cases, and you'll see wonderful discussion on your own questions. So it's not just me being super weird. Other people say the same thing. You send an event to yourself. Invent a name for it. You can call it kickoff. You can call it, I hate Torben for suggesting this stupid thing. There's also an atom there. And that atom will not be garbage collected. You'll have to live with it. That's another thing. And then you go into the prepare state. This is all fine. And in the prepare state, you take in the kickoff. And then you do your stuff there. And then you transition to the waiting state. And now I see some glares. Why is he saying this? So when you're in a state in a GenFSM, what happens if you get, and you're waiting on a timeout? What can go wrong? You're not allowed to answer.
Yes.
In a few seconds you can. What can go wrong? I'm sitting in a state, I'm waiting for a timeout. What can go wrong?
Some other thing can be already in my mailbox, for instance, and it will not, it just won't fire the timeout.
It could send you a message.
Yeah.
Because that's what you do. You have a GenFSM, you send it an event. And when that event happens, the timeout goes away. So you're never triggered to do this. And then you can do nasty things like calling this prepare thing again with timeout, using it as a function and not a callback. And this is where I'm going to get so medieval on you if you do that. Don't do it. It's just wrong Erlang. It's wrong OTP. Just wrong, wrong, wrong. Then we can take this over here. There. But I'll say the same thing 100 times again until you understand it. But don't do that. So just do these things. It's nice and easy and it works every time. It will not break your system. This is the important part. Yeah. So, when you know some of these things, and I'll do some other talks and get into more details at some point, should I use re-call? And this comes back to Robert saying, not every tool should be used for everything. Well, there are tools that should not be used for anything, but we will not name them right now. You get an idea there. So if you have something where you have a key, that links to some blob of data, then you have a good match because that's how we call things, key the blob of data there. And then when you can see that I have a primary vnode and some agent replicas, if you have that sort of thing, that I want a number of things to handle stuff, then it's also a good thing. And again, if the data is opaque to re-call, then it's good. You don't want to do a lot of business logic on top of that, then that's good. There, and then again, you do not want to re-implement re-KV. You probably have other semantics when doing like Heinz is doing. He has other things going on. So you don't want to reinvent re-KV. You, by the way, want to buy re-KV licenses there. But that's how you want to do that. So, good. Some resources here. Some Oriana Guerrero wrote this little re-core book. It goes into a lot of step-by-step things of setting up something with Real Core, and now you know some of the fundamentals underlying that. So all that handle handoff command will make a lot of sense to you now. There, and then Ryan has his blog posts you can steal from, and then Mark Allen from Basho, he has written this Erlang demo project, which is about a file store, a static file server forward thing. So there are things to go for, and you can come ask me for things as well. Thank you.
You knocked him dead.
I'm not going to bite your head off.
Okay.
You just threatened to kill us all if we
zero time. No. I said I wanted to get medieval. You don't kill people in medieval times. You keep them alive for a very long time. Yeah. That's severe pain when doing Java development. Come on.
I can come with one question.
Yeah.
Show my ignorance here. A while back, documentation for React Core was very sparse.
It depends who you asked. If you asked some people, said it was very bad. If you asked Basho, it said it didn't exist. Has it gotten better?
It's not bad yet.
Okay. It's almost getting to the bad stage.
Okay. No, but that's one of the things, because Basho, we've lost a lot of people, and some of them, they had knowledge in their heads, and they left the company, and you went around, where's that brain dump? There's no brain dump. So there's a lot of things where we need to document it and make sure that the new batch of engineers actually knows what's going on and don't just randomly go change code files, because that's kind of dangerous. You should actually know what you're doing when you're changing source code, especially when you have a ton of clients that pay a lot of money. You don't just randomly change stuff. So.
Yeah, I can just say as a comment that we were using internally in a project, and once we worked out what it was supposed to do, how to do it, it worked.
Yeah,
it actually did what it was supposed to do, and it did it correctly.
Yeah, so that's a good thing, but it's, yeah.
Actually, I have a question. Have you figured out what the hell the VNode proxy is doing?
Not fully, but we can talk about that, because I have some scrapings of it. Yeah, but you
should not take on that.
I think it's doing back pressure, and by the way, another question. You talked about cleaning up the dependency mess in React Core. How about cleaning up the dependency mess created in React KV during the 2.0 release? Because now it depends on Yokozuna. And if you want to just use React KV, you still have to download Yokozuna, and that means you have to download Solr, even though you are not going to use them.
Yeah, painful, isn't it? No, but seriously, that is on our to-do list, because we want to clean these things up there, because we have a ton of people, they're using React Core, and it actually, they're doing the oil thing every day, the ring, the fire, everything, every day, and then you run to them and say, by the way, buy a support contract, and they go, show me some effort into this. So we need to fix up React Core, we need to fix up React KV on these things, also because it's just not sustainable to work that way. So we will do something about that in the next year, 2016.
If it's really quick. Really
quick. Really quick. Is there effort going into adjusting to standard dependencies?
What is standard dependencies?
Not using Basho Forge Firebird that are changed and outdated.
No. But I'll explain to you that there's reasoning behind this, and I'll explain to you. Good.
Okay, thank you.